44. I am not doing Psalm 43. We finished last week Psalm 42, and I said I started looking at Psalm 43, and it's very similar. Psalm 43 is very similar to Psalm 42. So I said, well, I'm going to do Psalm 44. So I hope the lesson tonight will be a blessing to you. A couple of thoughts, and then I will read Psalm 44 to you, and hopefully we'll learn something. I called the lesson, and I'm not for sure, it just sort of stuck out in my mind. I called the lesson, Bad Things Happen to Good People.
Yes, sir.
Bad things happen to good people.
And they do.
In this psalm, we will discover that sometimes in life, bad things will happen to good people. But since God is good all the time,
amen.
Satan tries to destroy the goodness of God.
Amen.
Satan is on the attack on those of you who are trying to do the right thing. Now, this is something I found to be interesting, too. Bad things happen to good people. Oftentimes, people want to blame God. Satan certainly tries to blame God.
Amen.
Even the insurances, surely, when a storm comes through, the insurance writes up when a house is tore up or something's messed up, they always say it's an act of God.
Yep.
And I would like to say, how do they know it was God? How do they know Satan? He sees the prince and the power of the air.
Amen.
But that's the way they write it up. Satan is always trying to blame God for anything he can blame him for.
Amen.
All right. Some people believe that this psalm was written during the 70-year captivity, the Babylonian captivity. And the person writing this psalm was feeling homesick. The first part of it, he talks about some things that took place that he only heard about. He talks about things that he only heard about. And then we get to the middle of the chapter, and that's where we discover sometimes bad things happen to good people. All right? I just want you to be aware of that. So let me begin reading Psalm 44. We have heard with our ears, O God. Look, our fathers have told us what work thou didst in their days in the times of old. You ever hear the expression, you know, the good old days?
Yeah.
That's what he is pointing out here. He'd heard from his father and his grandfather and maybe mother and grandmother. Heard about the good old days.
Mm-hmm.
Verse 2. How thou, speaking of the Lord, how thou didst drive out the heathen with thy hand and plantest them. How thou didst afflict the people, speaking of the Canaanites and all the different ites there in the promised land that God was going to drive out. How thou didst afflict the people and cast them out. For they got not the land in possession by their own sword. That is, the psalmist is saying, it wasn't by our strength that we got the land, but it was by the power and strength of the Lord. Although they had to gird up their swords, they had to get their spears, they had to get their bows and arrows, but it was God who gave them the victory.
Amen.
And that's what he's wanting them to see.
Yes.
For verse 3, for they got not the land in possession by their own sword, neither did their own arm save them, but thy right hand. And Robert, whenever you read in the Bible, the right hand, you're talking about the right hand. You're talking about the power of God.
Amen.
Okay, anytime you come across that, it's the power of God. And thine arm, and the light of thy countenance, because thou hadst a favor unto them. That is, God was good to his people. God fought the battles for them. God delivered them. Verse 4, thou art my king, O God, command deliverances for Jacob.
Yeah.
Through thee will we push down our enemies. Through thy name will we tread them under that rise up against us. For I will not trust in my bow, neither shall my sword save me. But thou hast saved us from our enemies, and hast put them to shame that hated us. In God we boast all the day long, and praise thy name forever. Selah. Take time to think about that, he says. That's kind of what that is. It's kind of a timing thing there. Let's think about what we just read. He's talking about how well, and the things that he's giving us here are things that this particular writer, one of the sons of Korah, has heard about. He heard it from his father or his grandfather. And he's heard about how God had delivered the people. And they're telling the story, maybe sitting around a campfire and listening to the fathers and grandfathers through the years. They were there 70 years. So they were remembering how good it was, how beautiful Jerusalem was. Verse 9, here's where it switches. This is where it begins to switch right here. But thou hast cast off and put us to shame, and goest not forth with our armies. That is, it's like as though now they don't understand. We go out to battle, but yet, Lord, it's like you're not with us now. And we don't understand that. We can't beat and we can't defeat the enemy without you being with us.
Amen.
Verse 10, thou makest us to turn back from the enemy, and they which hate us spoil for themselves. They come in, they rob us, they steal from us, they take as they want to. Verse 11, thou hast given us like sheep appointed for meat, and hast scattered us among the heathen. Thou sellest thy people for naught, and dost not increase thy wealth by their price. Thou makest us a reproach to our neighbors, a scorn and a derision to them that are round about us. Thou makest us a byword among the heathen, a shaking of the head among the people. It's like as though they're looking and say, man, they're supposed to be God's people.
Yes.
Where is their God?
Yes.
And their enemies are all around them.
Amen.
And they knew and they heard the stories. And maybe even their fathers and forefathers told them about the power of God before this particular time begins to unfold. And this man who's writing is writing about what is going on in his life now. And there he's wondering, God, my father told me, my grandfather told me, and he's wondering, well, God, where are you now? And that's kind of his mindset.
Yeah.
For the voice of him that reproacheth and blasphemeth by reason of the enemy and avenger, all this has come upon us, yet have we not forgotten thee. Isn't that wonderful?
Yeah.
Even though all that had happened, it's like as though we're still not blaming God for it. Neither have we dealt falsely in thy covenant. That is, they're saying, we've kept your word, we've kept your promises, we've done what we know to do, and yet still all these things are happening.
Yes.
Now, isn't that familiar sometimes?
Yep. Sure is.
You know, haven't you tried to serve the Lord and do what's right? Do you still not have some problems? Do you still not have some difficulties?
Amen.
And that's what this writer is saying.
Yes.
We've tried to do what's right. We've tried to follow God. We've tried to obey His word and follow His covenant. And yet, all these things that we just read are happening to them. Verse 18, look at this. Our heart is not turned back. That is, we have not turned back against you, Lord. Neither have our steps declined from thy way. We're still following you. We still believe in you. What's a strong faith, isn't it? That's a strong faith. And boy, I want to have that kind of faith. Because every one of us are going to experience some difficulties in our life.
Amen.
And even sometimes when you're trying to do the right thing. Verse 19. Though thou hast sore broken us in the place of dragons, covered us with the shadow of death, if we have forgotten the name of our God or stretched out our hands to a strange God, shall not God search this out? Don't you know, God, we have not done these things? That's what he's saying. If we had done these things, you would know it.
Yes.
And you would know our heart.
Yes.
Does God not know your heart?
Yes.
And this song, this writer is saying, God, you know our heart. We've been trying to do the right thing.
Yes.
And yet these bad things are still happening.
Amen.
Verse 22, yea, for thy sake are we killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter.
Yes.
Awake. Why sleepest thou, O Lord? Arise. Cast us not off forever.
Amen.
Wherefore hidest thou thy face and forgettest our affliction and our oppression? For our soul is bowed down to the dust, our belly cleaveth unto the earth. Arise for our help.
Amen.
And redeem us for thy mercy's sake.
Yes.
Yeah, man, isn't that something?
Amen.
How often do we face hard or difficult times in our life? My understanding about life is somewhat controlled by the words that I read from Job when he said, man's days are few and full of trouble.
Yes.
The words of James, who says that our life is like a vapor. It appears for a little time and then vanishes away. But then on the other hand, I like the other hand.
Yes.
On the other hand, Nehemiah said, the joy of the Lord is our strength.
Amen.
David said, surely goodness and mercy. He's talking about presently, now.
Yes.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
Amen.
And I have this to look forward to, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Amen.
Sometimes in this life, surely, and sometimes, even now, sometimes my cup runneth over.
Amen.
Surely goodness and mercy will follow me. Wow. Praise the Lord. Even my cup runs over.
Amen.
Jesus said, he that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life.
That's right.
We are taught that God is our refuge and our strength, and that he is a very present help in the time of our need.
Amen.
And I just wrote this as a little extra, just for all of you, but for those of you who may be watching us by way of YouTube, sometimes I think his help is just a prayer away.
Amen.
I heard it said, we have not because we
ask
not. Indicating that what we just read, even the Christian life is not without trouble or heartache. When someone becomes a Christian, not only does God bless them, but also Jesus taught us that sometimes throughout our journey, sometimes we must take up our cross and follow him.
Amen.
The world, Satan, your flesh, all want to enslave you.
Amen.
And while God is good all the time, you are still constantly in a battle to defeat evil and ungodliness in your life.
Hallelujah.
And I'll say this, the flesh is weak.
Yes.
But thank God, the Lord is strong.
Amen.
The Lord is strong. Now, I've got a question. Here we go. Have you ever in your lifetime felt maybe that God is not listening to your cry? You ever felt that? You've been praying, but somehow doesn't seem to be getting through the ceiling or whatever.
Yeah.
Have you ever felt that God maybe wasn't listening? This particular person who wrote this, that's what he is teaching. He said, we've prayed, we've done the right thing, we're trying to do the right thing, we're even following the Lord, but it's like as though the Lord really isn't hearing us. We're still going through what we're going through. The sons of Korah are remembering how God had performed miracles for their fathers and forefathers.
Amen.
They had heard the stories of how God had performed miracles for them, escaped, delivered them from Pharaoh, took them into the promised land under Joshua, how he had opened up not only the Red Sea, but he also opened up and let them walk through on dry land through the River Jordan when they was going into the river. This psalm is both a prayer and a song.
Yes.
I found this to be interesting. This is a good thought I think the Lord gave me. This particular psalm was a prayer and a song. It would be sung at the temple whenever the nation was in trouble.
Amen.
And I thought this thought. How many of you remember when the Twin Towers were hit with those planes and those terrorists?
Yes.
Y'all remember that?
I can see
it. I said, this psalm that they sang when the nation was in trouble, very similar to what Americans do when we're in trouble.
Yes.
Regardless of party affiliation, we tend to sing and find comfort in the hymn, Amazing Grace. Just about everywhere they were singing Amazing Grace during that time. This temple, this church service, out in the street, they were singing Amazing Grace because it tends to comfort us when we need it.
Amen.
It also tends to strengthen our resolve and encourage us. Just like this psalm would have done for Israel. When Israel went into the promised land, God gave them instruction, David, to drive out all the heathen nations. Did he not? They didn't do it. The result is they still suffer today as a matter of disobedience to God. God was doing the battling, fighting for them. Under Joshua's leadership, as he led them into the promised land, he led them in 37 battles, and they had 37 victories. Unfortunately, the people began to intermarry, and problems soon began to arise. Instead of influencing the people or the other nations to worship Jehovah, the other nations influenced Israel to worship their gods. There is an admonition in the New Testament. Be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers.
Amen.
That is the admonition. They were to drive out the heathen so that all the nations around them would see how powerful that their God was. And they were to see how God loved his people.
Amen.
Let me ask you this, two questions. Is your God powerful?
Amen.
Does your God love you?
Oh, mercy, yes.
We know he's powerful, and we know that he loves us.
Yes.
Can he do even more than you ask or think?
Amen.
The sons of Korah were musicians in Israel, and they began to sing. They were in trouble. He just described some very dire situations, and they began to sing. And the people were encouraged by the song. In the New Testament, Paul says, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Y'all know that song?
Amen.
They had remembered. They were remembering. Instead of looking around them, seeing the nasty now and then, they were remembering how God had helped them when they were when they first entered into the promised land. Now, this is a story that you'll find written in the book of 2 Chronicles, 2 Chronicles chapter 20. You can write it down if you want, or just try to remember 2 Chronicles chapter 20. Jehoshaphat, the king, had been told that there was a vast army coming against Jerusalem. Now, it doesn't say how many men or how many Israelites there were, but they were far outnumbered by the army that was coming against them. They were somewhat concerned. They were wanting to know, you know, what's going to happen? You know, maybe they had an army of 40,000, the Israelites, but the other one had probably at least 250,000 soldiers coming against them. And one man, Doug, went to the king and said, "Don't worry, be happy. God is on our side."
Amen.
And so he said, "Go out and face them." Now listen to this. This is in the Bible. It's true.
Yes.
They went out and they knew they were the vast army was coming. Normally they tell number. I mean, they've mentioned as many as a couple hundred thousand soldiers, but here it just gives the number vast. So we know it exceeds that. And they're coming against them. There's three nations coming against that little nation of Israel.
My goodness.
And here they come, the vast army.
Yeah.
And Jehoshaphat called the elders and the people together and they prayed.
Yes.
And he said, "Okay, the Lord's going to help us."
Amen.
So ever how many there were, perhaps 40,000 or more Israelites went out against a vast army.
Yes.
And they met them at the top of a hill, which is a strategic thing.
Yes.
They're at the top of the hill. The army's coming up the hill. The vast hordes of army men are coming up the hill.
Mm-hmm.
King Jehoshaphat sent out the choir, all dressed in white. And they began to sing, "Our loving God will love us forever."
Amen.
They began to sing that God will love us forever.
Yes.
And they're out in front. I don't know how many there were, maybe several hundred of them dressed in white robes. Yes. They're at the top of the hill. They said, "Get out in front, choir." "Get out in front," you know. And they went out there and they began to sing. And that vast army looked up and saw those guys in the white robes singing, "God will love us forever."
Yep.
And the next thing you know, they turned their swords on each other. And they wiped out all three armies.
Praise
to every single soldier.
Yes.
And God fought the battle, but they went out and sang and was rejoicing before the battle began. I mean, they whipped him with a song, you know.
Praise the Lord.
I thought, wow, that is a real story.
Yes, it is.
God's loving kindness is forever.
Yes.
God had helped them all along the way. Even today, when a person is genuinely saved, there is a real flood of emotions that take place. Sometimes in my years of ministry, I've had the privilege of leading quite a number of people personally to the Lord, kneeling at an altar, kneeling at the pew, kneeling at the home, a couch or whatever, at the table, dinner table, talking to people about the Lord, even on the front porch and so forth. But every single time, there is a real flood of emotions.
Yeah.
Some people laugh with joy. Sometimes people have cried with joy. This is a joy of relief.
Yes.
Sometimes people break into singing and rejoicing.
Yes.
But what we know is we will not remain the same.
Amen.
Sometimes I've seen folks express all three emotions.
Yes.
joy and praise and rejoicing to Jesus. But I got to say this. You know, I'm just going to stop on this next thought just because it's going a little long. Nearly every time someone makes a commitment to God, Satan will go on the attack.
Amen.
And I'm going to finish with this last thought because I want everybody to hear this. This is an absolute wonderful weapon for you as a Christian. This is a wonderful weapon for you as a Christian. I mean, we battle every day. You'll battle Satan. You'll battle enemies. You'll battle so-called friends. You may even battle family members. But here's a weapon. Satan's worst enemy is a Christian that's filled with the joy of the Lord.
Hey.
Hallelujah to that. I'll finish this lesson next week. I just got to finish it. It's very good. All right. God bless you.
Amen.
Let's pray for our